Hello everyone, Joseph Todd here, Property Deal Sourcer, Edinburgh. Hope you are all having a good day, not like me in Scotland because it's freaking raining here. So, in this video, why I'm doing this video is because I get several messages from people who also want to do deal sourcing, and most of the time I get the same questions, so I decided to make a short informative video about deal sourcing and compliance. Basically, compliance, deal sourcing and compliance. You know, there is so much talk about what you should do or you shouldn't and how to become compliant. So basically, it will be giving you more sense if you understand, why you have to be compliant. What is it? What's the purpose of being compliant? What is all that fuss around it? So, you know, you as a deal sourcer, basically you are an estate agent. So you are, if you didn't know that, welcome, you are an estate agent. You are selling houses. So, and because you are an estate agent, yeah, you introduce a buyer to the seller. So you pass on properties. You have to take some kind of responsibility for what you do, right? For example, like when you have your investor, as a deal sourcer, you have your investor and you introduce a property or you pass a property to an investor, you did your due diligence, right? And so when you are doing that, you have to take some responsibility for the deal you have passed on. So of course the owner or the buyer has to do his own due diligence. But because you have found that deal and you are introducing that deal to someone, you are also responsible for what kind of deal you pass on. So for example, if you sell something that it's crap and the investor will lose money because of you, you have to take responsibility. And that's when the indemnity insurance comes in. So that's the purpose of indemnity insurance. So you give some advice. You say, this is the property which I am advising you to buy because it's a good deal. So there is your responsibility. So that's about indemnity insurance. That's why you need that. Now, as I say, you are an estate agent, but of course, there is some difference between an estate agent and you, but that's just a formality because an estate agent will, he will connect buyers and sellers for any type of property, where you as a sourcing agent, you don't just sell any properties, you find good investment deals which you pass on to your investors. And the other difference is that you are paid by the buyer, whereas the estate agent is paid by the owner. So back to the compliance, anti-money laundering, that's another important thing. You know, in property, we talk about tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands pounds, and it could be an easy way to launder money from, I don't know, from someone who is an investor, but you know, who knows where he got his money from. So that's another thing why you have to work on your compliance, because that's another part to register with HMRC for anti-money laundering supervision, which means that every time you get some money from an investor, you have to check his ID and figure out, see some proof from of the funds and understand where the funds comes from. So again, this is about HMRC anti-money laundering supervision, which you can register on the HMRC website and just follow their steps. It's very simple. It's basically you giving up yourself to HMRC and saying, hey, here I am. I'm dealing with money. Money comes to me and goes from me, so please supervise me, check on me. I'm willingly saying that I'm working in that area, you know? So that's basically what anti-money laundering supervision is. And then, of course, you have to take those steps seriously, and whenever you sell a deal, you know, check where the money comes from, check proofs, etc., keep it in a file. In case HMRC need to check on you, then you can prove, show all these proofs. And here we come to another point, because you are saving customers' private data, like bank statements, for example, passport, or even just, you know, personal details. So here it comes to be registered with ICO, which it's data protection. So when you register with ICO, you're basically saying that you willingly stand up to comply with the data protection rules, which, you know, how would I say it? If you don't do anything cheeky or stupid, you would comply anyway. For example, if I get a bank account or bank details from my customer, I make sure it's saved safely, so no third party can have access to it. I would do that naturally, but still, you have to register with ICO, and this is the way when you say that, yes, I will comply with these data safe safety regulations, and then you just do it, right? Now, I need to give some credit to Alistair Cunningham and his book, Whatever It Takes, because all the steps you have to do about the compliance are there. I have received, or I have been on more trainings. For example, I don't know if you have heard of Simon Taylor from Empowering Network. So, for example, with them, they also teach this more deeply, and they will help you to go through all the steps step by step. Here, just very shortly, I can tell you how I did it. Again, based on the book and based on the training I have got. So, first of all, you open your company. You register. When you're opening your company, it will ask you for a CIS code or CSI code. I'm not sure. So that's, you know, you choose as you choose estate agent, because you are an estate agent. You're dealing with selling and buying properties, and you act as an agent. When you have your company ready, go to the bank, ask for a bank account for on your company name, and ask for a client's account. I have used Barclays because, yeah, in Scotland, not every bank is willing to open clients' accounts. They complicated a little bit, so Barclays was easy to deal with. Now, client's account. Why do you need a client's account? You know, that's like an extra protection for your investor if he sends you your sourcing fee, and you know he has these 14 days for a refund. So if anything happens to you or your company, like your company goes bankrupt, that money is protected. I personally think it's a little bit over protected, because to be honest, if I agree with an investor, look, you give me £3,000, within 14 days I give you that money back, then I will freaking give that money back if something happens, you know, it's my personal responsibility. But, you know, officially it looks really good that there is some real protection even from the bank, because it's a client's account, yeah? So we say, open your company, open a bank account with a client's account. When you have that, register with PRS, Property Redress Scheme. That's when, if there are any disputes, serious disputes, which you don't want to have, and if you are doing your business right, you will never come to that point. But just in case, you have to be registered with PRS or the Ombudsman. So if there are disputes, the client, your client, can actually contact this third-party organization or entity who will help to come to some agreement or something like that. So that's the PRS, the Property Redress Scheme. I am with them. Someone is registered with the Property Ombudsman. That's the same service. It's just two different organizations. When you have that, you need to register with the ICO. Just Google ICO.co.uk, I think. And when you have that, you register with the HMRC for anti-money laundering supervision. Now, all that process can take about 1 month. There is something else. Yeah, I think you need to follow these steps in that order, because I think you can't register for HMRC supervision unless you have your bank details already ready. I think I was waiting for the bank details, and that's why I couldn't register with the anti-money laundering supervision. So let's recap it quickly one more time. So open your LTD, CSI code, estate agent, go to the bank, get a bank account and client's account, I'm getting mixed up. Then PRS, Property Redress Scheme, ICO, HMRC, Anti-Money Laundering. So you need all these steps. Now what I want to tell you, my mistake at the beginning was that I spent too much time with creating my website, getting, you know, compliance done, and I was feeling so fantastic that now I'm a compliant deal sourcer. Hey, you know, I'm the boss. But you know, that's not the main thing, because you won't make money just because you are compliant. And also, again, a mistake I made, or where I spend unnecessarily long time, is that I was looking for deals like crazy. I had awesome deals, you know, but I haven't had an investor, so I didn't know where to sell those deals. And that's a problem, because for example, when you get a deal from an agent and you shake hands on, you know, you promise him, look, I will make every effort possible to find you a buyer for this property, and you walk away, you send out your deal and nobody buys it, that's quite bad. You know, I like to do business when I say something. I like to make sure that it happens. There's no excuses, no, not because of somebody else or whatever. When I say something, it has to be like that, or then I rather don't say anything. So it's a little bit problematic, because you have to have investors and you have to have deals. So what I would suggest, look for investors first. Look for investors. You know, say, look, I'm operating in this area. I know my area well. I can do the legwork for you. I can do the viewings. I can find properties for you. Even if it's for free, doesn't matter. You just have to get yourself out there and do some actions in order to success later, to succeed later. So what I would do right now, with the knowledge I have after a half year doing it, and I'm still at the beginning, just I'm telling you my experience, find an investor, get a property for him, maybe first, second, couple property, even for free or for some really small fee. When you have that, promote your success, promote your results, and get more investors, and then the deals will come, you know, the deals will come. Okay, so I think that was all what I wanted to say. As you know, I operate in Edinburgh and I source property deals. Right now, after 6 months, I have much better understanding about the area. I can see already patterns. I can see which deal could work where and which deal doesn't work in that area. So if you happen to be an investor who have already some money saved and you want to buy a property in an amazing city of Edinburgh, which is a second London in the UK, then you know who you contact. So thanks very much and have a really good weekend. Bye-bye.